Again, thank you for joining us today for this final session of the AgriBility National Training Workshop Encore webinars for this year. My name is Paul Jones. I manage the National AgriBility Project, which is headquartered at Purdue University. And our topic for today is a Veterans in Agriculture discussion. Our presenters, Manshi Ramdas from USDA and Joe Ricker from National AgriBility Project. Some of you may not be familiar with AgriBility. We are sponsored by the U.S. Department of Agriculture, and we focus on helping virtually anyone in agriculture with virtually any type of disability or functional limitation. Every one of the AgriBility projects around the country is a partnership between a land-grant university and at least one nonprofit disability services organization. And there are currently 21 state projects around the country. In addition, as I mentioned before, there's a National AgriBility Project. Again, that's at Purdue University through the Breaking New Ground Resource Center. And our partners on that grant include Goodwill of the Finger Lakes, Osteoarthritis Action Alliance, AgriSafe Network, Colorado State University, and Washington State University. If you'd like to know anything more about AgriBility or the work we do, please check out agribility.org. There are approximately 160 archived webinars that you can check out at your convenience on that site. I want to give you a little background on our presenters today. Manshi Ramdas serves as the Military Veterans Agriculture Liaison in the U.S. Department of Agriculture. In this role, he establishes effective partnerships with federal agencies, state and local governments, faith-based organizations, and nonprofits. In addition, he aids beginning veteran farmers and ranchers by providing expert information to veterans, transitioning service members, and military spouses in regard to employment, education, and entrepreneurships. Prior to serving at USDA, Mr. Ramdas worked in the Defense Intelligence Agency as a diversity and inclusion specialist and special emphasis program manager. Mr. Ramdas served in the U.S. Army as a combat medic from 1984 to 2007 and retired as a command sergeant major. Joe Ricker is a retired Army colonel and the founder of At Ease Orchard, a nonprofit focused on getting veterans, first responders, and their family members into beekeeping and other farm activities. He is also the Veteran Outreach Coordinator for National AgriBility and Indiana AgriBility, a position through which he mentors veterans and provides guidance to dozens of veterans every month on pursuing their passion of getting into agriculture. Joe is also the president of Veterans in Farming, an organization that provides mentorship to help veterans be successful in homesteading, farming, ranching, and other types of agriculture. This time, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I am going to pull up Mr. Ramdas' presentation here. Okay, I believe you can see Mr. Ramdas' presentation, and I'll turn things over to him.
All right. Thank you, Paul and Joe, for this invite to participate and partner with the National AgriBility Project. As was said before, I'm the Military Veteran Agriculture Liaison at USDA. This position became permanent in 2017. Mr. Bill Ashton was the former Military Veteran Agriculture Liaison, the first permanent employee. I'm the second permanent employee in this position, and I took over the position last October of 2022. When my colleague Bill retired. So we're continuing on with the Military Veteran Agriculture Liaison Program at USDA. USDA, prior to the permanent position, we did have like political appointees in this position. And I think two political appointee before Bill was permanently appointed, Bill Ashton and then myself. So now we have continuity and, to be a representative for veterans at USDA And not only for farming and ranching, but we're going to cover employment, education, and entrepreneurship at USDA. The idea is to outreach and communicate USDA programs to our military family, we call it. So that include transitioning service members, vets, military spouses, and also the dependents, the children of the military family. Because at USDA, like I said, we have an opportunity for the entire family. And we want to ensure that that message is presented to our constituents. Next slide. And why veterans? I won't read every bullet, but there are approximately 17 million vets. If you look on Google, you might see eight point something, but that number is declining, reducing because of the World War II vets that are a trip, that population is being reduced. Veterans make up around 8% of non-metropolitan residents compared to 6% U.S. residents overall. And when you look at transitioning service members, we're looking at 192 to 250,000 transitioning service members that transition out of the military on an annual basis. And that number fluctuates depending on the current mission and engagement of the DoD. So there are over 17 million, as we say, veterans in America. And when we look at our 2017 Census of Agriculture data, you're looking at 370,619 veterans that are farmers, and that accounts for 11% of the 3.2 million farmers in America, or overall producers. When you look at that small number, 11%, actually, it's a lot of vets participating in farming. And when you look at veterans producer, you're looking at about $41 billion in agricultural products sold in 2017. And when you break that further down, you're looking at $22 billion were crop sales and $19 billion were sales of livestock and livestock products. And then when you look at small business, and there's some data from the SBA here, you can see that veterans again are making a big impact in small business when you look at the bottom line on the amount of money and how many vets are participating in small business. So veterans, when they transition, they want meaningful work and quality of life that can be achieved through farming, ranching, community leadership, or owning a small business. And of course, not to mention working in federal and private sector. So USDA, we value veterans. And we want vets to be a part of our mission. So, feeding America and to keep our food supply abundant, safe, and secure, preserve and strengthen rural communities, and restore and conserve the environment. We think that veterans can play a very important role in doing those things as we move forward. Next slide, please. This is an example slide of veterans that we feature. Navy vet Carlina Williams started her own juice business. The guys rappelling on top are smoke jumpers in the U.S. Forest Service that will transition into that sort of role based on air assault and airborne experience in the Army or any service. Below, Air Force veteran Rupert Richards. He's a retired Air Force E-9 that set up the first agricultural commodity food grader apprenticeship program at USDA. And of course, Marine Corps vet Calvin Riggleman, he went back home and took over the family farm. Many veterans are doing that, where they're taking over the farms and taking it to the next level. An Air Force veteran, Angela Mulder, she volunteers at different farms to gain knowledge to get into farming. Next slide. And this is an addition, it's a recent addition, because at the USDA, we're focusing on military spouse employment and opening all other opportunities for military spouses. When we look at military spouses, you're looking at it, the highest unemployment rate in America, it's at 21 to 22%. At USDA, we're trying to help. So how are we helping? We hired a full-time military spouse that manages the military spouse employment program. So we have a full-time FTE that was hired in the last fourth quarter last year, FY23, to manage military spouse employment, and more importantly, retention at USDA, because they move around a lot and they might lose their employment. So we're trying to maximize remote and telework opportunities to assist them in maintaining employment. And I'll just highlight Liz Colby. She's an engineer. You know, that pool, the military spouse pool, they're very educated. You're looking at bachelor's degree and above, you know, which is really a talented pool that's available that, you know, that they can fit in any agency. But what's important is that at USDA, I think we're like the first agency that have a relationship with DOD, Military Spouse Employment Program. And not only that, we were the first to hire a full-time employee to manage military spouses. And that's because our secretary is highly involved in this area with the Secretary of Defense to work on spouse employment and how we can help. The military spouses also, you know, 42% of them are entrepreneurs. And in addition to that, when you look at that 42%, USDA has many rural business programs that they can participate in. So, of course, we're outreaching to that segment of the military population to ensure that we educate them on what we have to offer. Next slide. And, you know, that old slogan, veterans don't know what they don't know. There are so many things out there. We ensure that we reach out to these vets and transitioning service member and military spouses ahead of time to ensure that they know about USDA and what we have to offer. For example, right before the Christmas holiday, I did a webinar to service members stationed in Beijing, China, and Bangkok, South Korea, in that area in Asia. It was Thursday at 8 p.m. here. It was Friday morning over there. So through our Foreign Agriculture Service, we're able to conduct a Zoom meeting with these folks and to let them know what USDA has to offer. So those are the things that we do. where we're connecting with these vets way ahead of time as they're transitioning out. I had a conversation with a Air Force service member this morning. She is planning like 2 years out from separation to get a farm going in Oklahoma, to start now and then transition into that when her and the husband separate from the service. In addition to that, her husband is in a, it's called EFMP program, the Exceptional Family Members Program, I think it was. And through that program, you know, it's like a family member with special needs. And this family member, you know, it's in a wheelchair. And this person is supposed to help this service member when they get their farm together. And guess what? I told her about the National Agribility Project. And I did give Joe's name and number. So they will reach out to you. We use data from different sources. These are two sources that we get data from and combine it with our data at USDA and other sources to find out where the vets are and how we can assist them. Suicide is it's everyone's responsibility. We always stress that point with veterans, and of course maintaining ADD-214, because that's a very important document. Next slide. And these are the three key areas that we focus on: employment, education, entrepreneurship. Next slide. Employment, next. Employment, you know, when I separated from the military, my first job was with DOD. And then after 2.5 years, I transitioned to USDA. And it was through the USDA employment program that I was hired full-time to work in the human resources department at USDA, where I managed the diversity program and the veterans employment program at that time, and many other programs. So at USDA, we make it a point that to hire vets. And not only that, we have goals that 25% of all new employees at USDA, we're expecting 25% of new hires to be veterans. So 1 out of 4 new hires we're expecting to be vets. And we're setting a goal for military spouses to increase annually by 2% what the total amount that we hire, to increase it every year, and to maximize our policies to support military spouses for them to maintain their jobs. But at USDA, you know, we look at pretty much any military occupation we'll have something for. And if we don't have something, we could train you through our apprenticeship programs. Next slide. Paid apprenticeship, I talked about that. We can train any vet to get into agriculture, commodity, food grading, food inspection, or wildland firefighters. We have nonprofits, and many farms are picking up where they have apprenticeship programs available that can be, you know, there's a search and a partnership with ATRA and CAT. It's a nonprofit that we fund as well, USDA. Of course, it's a competitive grant. We just don't hand out the money. They compete for it. But ATRA is a primary way where they're operating in over 45 states, where a veteran can look up and do a search in any state, and it will pull up a list of farms that offer free training, internship, and apprenticeship training to actually work on a farm, hands-on experience. And they also run a course called Arm to Farm. It's a 5-day course. So there are a lot of training. Dairy Grazers, ATRA, And of course, we work with the DoD Skill Bridge program. That's where the service members are released within 6 months of separation, and they can participate in internship opportunities with USDA and on farms. I think Joe will share. He's a DoD Skill Bridge member. And I'm proud to say that DoD Skill Bridge is very accessible now, very user friendly, and I can connect with them at any time that I want. And I have full access with our partnership where I can list our agencies and help farms or any agriculture operation to expedite your application process if you need help with that. Next slide. These are some of the resources that we talked about. I didn't mention anything, but at USDA, we heavily rely on the hiring authorities to hire vets and bring them on without competition. And one of our agencies got that process down to 21 days, where we can send a resume to a hiring official. They will look at the resume, interview the vet or the transitioning service member, and they can make an offer right after that interview, a tentative offer. So it's a quick process, 21 days. And I think that's a great record. Next slide. Next. At USDA, you know, when we do outreach, we always tell vets, or if they connect with us about careers in agriculture, we always tell them, hey, if you're thinking about agriculture, ensure that you spend your GI Bill or your tuition assistant to get a degree that will transition into a permanent job with USDA. Of course, we have different types of opportunities at USDA. We have scholarship, fellowship, internship through the Pathways program, summer internship for high school students, and also, you know, Job Corps. We're a big candidate with Job Corps to assist students that are getting out of high school or even high school dropout and go to Job Corps. We could prepare them to get a job in the federal government or to get into the military service, because it's an area where you teach them discipline and structure and prepare them for the workforce. Next slide. And here I talked about ATRA early on. ATRA is our biggest apprenticeship partner because of the list of farms in every state. They're located in 45 states. And I think, yeah, they hired folks to start in Florida, and they're expanding to cover America. Farmer Vet Coalition is our big partner. Of course, Agribility is our big partner. I got in trouble. I thought I had it on the slide, but Agribility is it's a very partner with USDA. Boost to Business Reboot Ag Focus, that's something new that I was able to work with the New England VBOC, Veteran Business Outreach Center, and the SBA to combine the Boost to Business Reboot and focus it with agriculture. On January 22nd, we'll have the third course that the New England VBOC is the lead, but USDA partner with VBOC. And of course, Agribility and many different farmers and ranchers participate on that agenda as well. The USDA Beginning Ranching and Farming webinar, we ran one last October 31st, November 1st, 2 days. That was the first time we ever did anything like that. We're going to continue to do those. We had over 870 people that registered. And when you look at that boots to business one, so far we did two sessions, and we trained over 300 already. The beginning ranching and farming webinar, for day one, we had 370, day two, 212. So the boots to business webinar is they're making it smaller to cover just one day instead of 2 days. And of course, we have the extension in every state. The extension service with the universities, one that's famous, of course, many of them get grant, they compete for grant money. The one in Texas, Battleground and Breaking Ground, Syracuse University is another one. So there are many extension service that offers beginning ranching and farming training, and then there are nonprofits, many. There's one in Hawaii that I refer folks to. There's one almost in every state. Next slide. These three grant programs are the primary grant program that fund nonprofits and extension services to put on beginning ranching and farming training for veterans. So these programs are key to funding nonprofit organization that provide training for the beginning ranching and farming. It's a deliberate effort that we do to fund these organizations to assist us to train and prepare vets to get into agriculture. Next slide. Those are our education resources. Next slide, please. There's some links here. Paul, do you think I could play one? The first one, if you can click on that. I don't know if we have time. If we don't have time, you don't have to.
Yeah, I may be able to play it, but I'm not sure it will have sound. That's the only question I have at this point. Maybe I can copy that link and then play it at the end.
Sure. Yeah. Those three links are, the first one is a veteran that brought back a brewing company in Butte, Montana, an old brewing company, and he were able to tap into some USDA programs to help his business out. It's an up and running business, still good to go. Second one is a vet that capitalized on the EQIP program, Environmental Quality Incentives Program. And the third one is of another vet that used USDA programs to start his farming operation. Next slide. And of course, at USDA, we have, let you know up front, we have in each state, we have a beginning farming and ranching state coordinator. Those state coordinators are located on farmers.gov. You can find out who these folks are. We also have, not in every county, but we have coverage, USDA Service Center. Some county will have an office, some county will be supported by a regional office, but we have coverage for every county and every state in America with our service centers. And in our service centers are the USDA experts. Those are the people that you'll have to go to talk about the loans, microloans, operating loans, farm ownership loans, or enhancing land quality. The Environmental Quality Incentives Program, these are the experts, and those are the people that you'll go to see to get information on the different programs that you see on the slide. Easement Program, the Conservation Stewardship Program. Crop Insurance, you could connect with our Risk Management Agency to take a look at that. And of course, technical assistance, conservation technical assistance from the Natural Resources Conservation Service. And, you know, many, many vets have been successful using our programs. Next slide. This is one, Josh Eilers. He's a former Army Ranger, and he's got a very awesome ranch in Austin, Texas, raising Wagyu cattle. He's been very successful, and he has been able to use some of USDA programs. Of course, we partner with SCORE, where you can get a business mentor assigned to you. These are retired business executives that can assist you in finalizing your business plan or giving you pointers on getting your business plan together. Of course, we have a lot of resources and different types of agencies. If you're getting into farming, or if you have a rural business, our rural business programs, you can connect with our rural development business programs to assist you, or you can take a look at maybe our business and industry loans, our value-added producers grant. Those are different programs that the folks in the service centers can help you out with. Next slide. This link on this slide could tell you if you're rural. It is important to know at times if you're rural or not, to tap into various programs. Of course, the USDA does have a urban agriculture program as well. That's a full-up program with a grant as well. That office is being set up right now, and it's a up and running office, fully functional at this time, and they're looking to expand that program. And of course, we ensure that we let vets know, and the transitioning service members, and also military spouses, because of that high entrepreneurship percentage of mill spouses. We want to bring them in the fold and let them know that USDA have the rural business programs that they can possibly use to enhance and expand their businesses. Next slide. It's just an example here. This is like current info to kind of give you an idea. Farm Service Agency direct and guaranteed loans, the amount that were issued out. Rural development single family home loans, rural development business loans, the value added producers grant. It's a big number, but it's around over 100,000, 120,000. I didn't put the number down, that were issued out to veterans. And then the EQIP program, 28.7 million awarded to veterans. Just to give you an idea, that I'm starting to look at data internally and to look at, areas where we can improve, as I'm looking at this data, and to ensure that vets are participating in our programs, and there's actual, the dollar amount that that's going out to veterans. Next slide. Food insecurity. It's a. It's not, strange to vets. I mean, vets are not immune to that. Military spouses are not immune to it. You're looking at 25% of military spouses experience food insecurity, and that's active duty. So, food insecurity, we signed the a memorandum of understanding with the Veterans Administration, Veterans Health Administration, and we meet monthly with their with partners, USDA Food and Nutrition Service, and we're working collaboratively together to ensure that our that we are outreaching and getting the information out to active duty, transitioning service members, and veterans and their families, throughout the entire year. And we want to do a good job at that. That's why we have this permanent partnership and we meet once a month. Of course, SNAP benefits, we made sure that working with VA, that VA does screen for veterans in food insecurity, but if they're found food insecure, then there's a conversation to ensure that they're enrolled if they're willing or want the help. So that was a new addition. Probably 2 years ago, we did that through our partnership. Next slide. And there are some other resources for you. And Paul, feel free to share the slides with the attendees. Next slide. And if you need to get a hold of me, veterans@usda.gov, you can get in touch with me at any time. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Mr. Ramdas. We definitely appreciate all that excellent information. I'll turn things over to Joe Ricker for his part of the presentation, and then we'll come back for Q&A. And again, please feel free to enter questions in the chat at any point. Also, I'm going to be posting the survey link again, so don't forget that before you take off. Thank you.
Hey, thank you, Paul. Can you hear and see me okay in the slides?
Looks good.
Okay. Hey, thanks everybody. So I'm the AgriAbility Veteran Outreach Coordinator, and I want to talk to you kind of what we do with AgriAbility to collaborate with partners across the nation. A lot of them are on today. You just saw a note from North Carolina. You'll see many notes out there, and they are part of our community of interest. And I'll talk a little bit about that. So what we're doing at AgriAbility to kind of get after that is we've established a community of interest. We meet once a month. Sometimes we're off a month here or there, like in December, but we have a lot of organizations that are nonprofits. Some of them, like us, are funded through USDA to conduct their programs, like Monshi, like Ram mentioned. Some of them are under the Ag Vet program. Some of them have beginning farmer ranchers. But what happens with AgriAbility is we will get a call, just like Ram does, just like other organizations do, and say, "Hey, I'm a farmer. I'm a veteran. And I want to become a farmer. Where do I start? Where do I go?" So, being the guy in Indiana, we do have connections in the states through AgriAbility. We wanted to cohere together all the veteran opportunities in agriculture. So we have Heroes to Hives by Dr. Adam Engrao out of Michigan State, Farmer Veteran Coalition, and their chapters participate, Veteran Farm of North Carolina with Robert Elliott. And on and on. You'll see many of them on there that do great work. And again, they go through that competitive grant process through USDA. And they really are that, boots on the ground for a lot of veterans becoming farmers. So we hold that community of interest once a month. And I put in the chat if anybody would like to participate. It's really just an opportunity to collaborate, find out what's in your space. Maybe get some mentorship from somebody that's been around a little bit longer as you stand up something or have an idea, to leverage. Because it's not about who owns the program. It's really about who do we collaborate to make people, make veterans more satisfied in their retirements and in their opportunities out there. We also have a veteran and beginning farmer website. under the National AgriAbility Project. I put the link right there. If you click on that link, you'll see a lot of our resources that are grouped together there as an opportunity, again, for veterans to kind of see what's out there. Please take a look at that. And if you'd like to be added into that as well, I put my information in the chat. So we do a lot of national outreach. Miriam said, I participate and work with the Boots to Business farmer version of it out of the Northeast. And we really try to encourage that and spread the word on that. Also, I do get a lot of phone calls, just like Ram does. I have an orchard and bees and a business plan and everything for my farm out in Indiana. So we do some mentorship where I reference them to better mentorship if there's something in their area. And again, that goes back to the collaboration. In the military, we would have called it understanding your battle space. You know, who's to the left or right, who's to the left or the right of you that can help. We have a DoD skill bridge we accept at AgriAbility. Ram helped us get currently, and he's on the line, Brad Erdell, under the DoD skill bridge program. We've also mentored a few people, being a skill bridge alum myself, and Brad being in the program now. Happy to kind of mentor people on the opportunities in their space and their service to get into the skill bridge program, because it doesn't necessarily, when you look at the skill bridge program on the DoD website, doesn't necessarily flavor to agriculture well. So we try to, you know, shape that and to help veterans get into the SkillBridge program within the guidance of DoD. And then, as Machi had mentioned, Ram had mentioned the USDA Veteran Beginning Farmer Program. That was a great startup by USDA that we helped participate in. We're working on a couple partnerships with the Department of Veterans Affairs. So as AgriAbility assists a lot of people challenged with disabilities, the VA has then a lot of opportunities for veterans to overcome some challenges. So we've partnered and working through the process with Compensated Work Therapy as an official VA partner. And then we just doing some research and doing some things with the VA under the VA Farms Program. The VA Farms Program started about 3 years ago as an opportunity for the VA to see if agriculture would assist veterans, in rehabilitation or recreation or therapeutics. It has concluded. There's about 6 or 7 locations that have decided to keep it. And then there is a report due out to Congress. So trying to monitor all that as a interested party to see, again, where, if a veteran calls us up or we know of a veteran that would like to get into agriculture, how we maintain that resource and direct them to opportunities for them as well. What I usually say to veterans when they are getting started, you know, and it's great to be a veteran talking to veterans, right? So we have the same language for all the veterans out there. You know, what do you want to be in 5 years? Everybody's heard that through mentorship and other avenues. I'm sure Command Sergeant Major Ramdas has said that to a few people in his career. You know, get into the Boots to Business for farmer. You know, there are opportunities with that to kind of put that vision down, see if it's real, write your business plan. Also talk to the state. I also reference them to talk to the state small business development centers. Most states have them, and kind of write out what their dream sheet is. Another military term, and I apologize for that. You know, then they look at understanding their market, you know, getting into visiting farmers markets, ask around. It's really funny, you know, everybody said, not everybody, I'll say some veterans come in with a great idea. Good story of a gentleman down in North Carolina who wanted to start a kale farm, and he found out that kale was not as purchased a resource down in the North Carolina or southern states as okra or greens or other things. So sometimes there's a reason why either culture or climate or something like that doesn't allow for people to, for their business to thrive in agriculture. So we usually talk to them a little bit about that, do your market analysis, and then walk into them into taking training as needed. There's programs like food safety. I just saw two food safety aspects at Purdue were just funded through the specialty crop grant program from USDA. So again, there's other training that we would recommend or kind of direct them to based upon their story and what they want to do. And then it goes back to looking for resources, right? So once they have their plan, they start looking for, encourage them to look for resources. And that's where, you know, the USDA can play a large part of the program between the EQIP program for pollinator plots or high tunnels. Look at nonprofits. The Farmer Veteran Coalition has a fellowship fund that provides money to veterans to succeed in farming. And then there's mentors and other areas. And in the end, really, I encourage the veterans to just enjoy it, you know, enjoy what they're doing. Look at it, you know, within the scope that they want. But really, you know, farming and agriculture, I think, can be a big boost for a lot of morales out there. I did post, this is the Boots to Business Farmer Rancher program. That's going to be going on January 22nd. I put the link for it in the chat. It will go to an events link that will allow people to sign up for it. It's an excellent program. It gives opportunity to meet a lot of people virtually, as well as hearing from other programs that are in process. It really starts to get that veteran's mind churning on what do I want to be when I get out of service. Or I'm out of service and I want to get out of my job and do some sort of agriculture, really starts to get their mind turning on what they want to do and what the opportunities and things are there. So lastly, I'm just going to leave you with my email, my contact information. Feel free to email me if you want to be a part of the Veteran COI. Happy to add you. Our next one will probably be in February. And I'm happy to add you and look at the products you have to add your link and information to our website as well. And Paul, that's all I had, and I'll push it back to you.
Okay, thank you a lot, Joe. We do have some time for questions. I would encourage you to check through the chat area. We've had a lot of good information shared there in terms of contacts, organizations that people work with. Joe, again, has shared the Boots to Business link that you can click directly on, and also information about joining the Veterans Community of Interest. Someone else, Daryl Anderson, indicated he has a radio feature if people are interested in sharing stories on that. So I would encourage you, if you have questions specifically, to go ahead and either enter those in chat, or you can use the raise hand option under the reactions icon. And while we're looking through the list for questions, I did pull up one of the videos that Mr. Ramdas had referenced in his presentation. So I will do my best to share that with sound and give that a shot here.
Tony Olson is a member of the Great Falls Little Shell Tribe. He is also a veteran and served 20 years in the Army National Guard as both an enlisted member and a commissioned officer. After retiring from the military, Tony embarked on a new venture and decided to revitalize Butte Brewing Company. The brewery had originally opened in 1880 and closed its doors in 1964. On July 10th, 2015, after a 51-year hiatus, Tony reopened the iconic facility in Butte, Montana. Tony used USDA Rural Energy for America funding to install 80 solar panels on the brewery's roof, saving the company about $350 per month in energy costs. Tony also worked with Headwaters RC&D to obtain a loan through the USDA Rural Development's Intermediary Relending Program to get the funding needed for a canning line to expand into canned beer distribution. With this new equipment, Butte Brewing Company is able to meet the supply requirements for their Tommyknocker Brew, which is the official beer of Butte's Expedition League baseball team. And they now have an alternative method for packaging and selling the 527 gallons of beer that each of their craft batches yield.
All right. Hopefully that was audible for you. Looking through chat again, we do have information shared about Battleground to Breaking Ground program and other programs there. The Farmer Veteran Coalition Fellowship Fund is open also through February 14th. And seeing if there are any other specific questions at this point. I guess to either Joe or Mr. Ramdas, if you encounter a veteran that, for example, has no land or very little farming experience, what would be the best way to refer them to either, an agency or a website, or what would be the best option there?
So you're saying a veteran that what now? No land and no experience?
But is interested in farming.
Yeah, without experience and land? Is that specific? All right, so this is how I do it. I get email and phone calls pretty much all day. So based on the need of the vet, I'll do an assessment because it's not all the same. There'll be different things at every time. So one thing that I say up front to the vets is, hey, farming is hard. Start small. And, you have to understand, why are you getting into farming? First thing folks want to do is buy land. Land ownership. Yeah, I need land. The course on the 22nd is we got a farm credit vice president for veterans outreach. He's going to talk about land ownership and those type of things. So we want to give these vets a good baseline knowledge before they decided to do all these other things. The first thing, land is an issue, but depending on what else, is going on with this veteran, do they know what they're doing, first of all? So we're going to get them to the training that they need. So depending where they are, for example, give you an example. If someone wanted to produce honey in, let's say Georgia, there's the Heroes to Hives program. There's an 8-month online, there's in-person course. And that's through a nonprofit that receives USDA funds. I get calls from veterans in Hawaii. There's Ho'ola Farms in Hawaii. It's a nonprofit that is funded by USDA that provide the training to get them through training. So I look at all the different scenarios, and depending where they're located, to link them on to the resources that's going to help prepare them to get into, the heavy stuff later on. So based on their need, we do an assessment. And, I'm an Army medic. I say, okay, after I do the assessment, then I write the prescription for that person to get them started. So not all of them, will come to you with the same things every time. It'll be different every time. And based on their needs, then we will link them up with the resources. But what's most important every time, it's a business plan. Get the business mentor. Start an LLC. Do a small operation for at least 12 months. That way you'll get the three-year requirement that's needed, that's required for USDA to become a beginning farmer rancher and to access, you know, to apply for the loan programs and different programs that we might have. So it's not, you know, it's kind of like assess, find out their needs, and then do the prescription. So it's different every time. One size doesn't fit all. And we rely heavily on our partners, Joe Ricker and AgriAbility. But then Joe, as a farmer himself, you know, it's a good referral. And Joe, that Sergeant Major you connected me with, I already sent a vet that was interested in honey to him. You know, I asked him before, you know, and then, you know, the nonprofits, they help us out a lot. You know, our nonprofit organization, the Extension Service, of course, our beginning ranching and farming state coordinators and our county offices. So there's a lot of help available. And, you know, land access is a problem, right? But if you decide what you want to do, and if you have that, hey, this thing's going to work, before you get into it, try something out at a smaller scale and then, you know, go and get whatever it is. You can lease land, right? There are other ways to get land where you'll have a land or a farm that's in a family or senior farmers, and they're not using the land. They might want to lease it. So there are different options. Lease option is always a good option to look at how to lease land. I know in the New England region, there's a nonprofit called Land for Good. They do a great job with land access. And, you know, they have a great program that they teach on land access as well. So I hope I can, that I, you know, answer your question.
Thank you very much. That's very complete. Appreciate that. Joe, do you have any other thoughts on that?
Yeah, the only thing I was going to add is, and just highlight what Ram said, is that really that plan is key, because you don't know what training you want to take. You don't know how much land you need until you start to write out a plan. So I always really emphasize them going after, you know, what they want to be, where they want to do agriculture, writing that plan, and then, you know, looking at all the resources, because the resources can become rather overwhelming. And there are some great ones that pop up, you know, in the chat, but not every veteran, you know, wants to do some of those things. So you really got to have that plan. A lot of them come out without the plan, but if they have a plan, then, you know, they can find a mentor like Ram or I and say that this is what I want to do. Hard to determine how many acres you want. Big difference between cows and.
And, I see in the chat, ATRA is an amazing nonprofit. So, you know, it's a great resource. I mean, where sometimes, you know, there might not be much in a state, and ATRA might be the Arm to Farm program, you know, is present in that state. So, you know, like I said, any vet that connect with me, I check out where they're located first, and then I pull the resources based on their location and need and get them going. But you know, just that new program, the Boots to Business Reboot with Ag Focus, I think that's a really great program. And the New England VBOC agreed to do it once a quarter, and the course that USDA did for the first time, we're gonna probably try to do two a year, combined with the nonprofit, the Extension Service, ATRA, the different nonprofits. I mean, there's a lot of resources out there. We just have to, assist these transition and service members, vets and family members, based on their needs. I think that's the best way to do it. And, I have folks to help me in every state, the beginning ranching farming state coordinators. They're very experienced people. They're all USDA employees and program areas, and some of them are farmer and ranchers. So,
great. Okay, well, thanks so much, Joe and Ram, for all that great information today. I will leave the chat open because there's so much information there. If you'd like to peruse that before you leave today, we also had mentions about incubator programs, and there's links there too. So if you're interested in that, please check that out. And again, we'd appreciate your filling out the webinar survey that I've got listed there. We will, again, have this archived hopefully within a few days if you'd like to check back on agribility.org. So thank you again to everybody that participated, and we wish you a good rest of the day.
Thank you, sir.